Jada, UAE Warriors, you know, you got a fight coming up, and there's two shows at the end of the month. There's one, I believe, on the 25th and the 27th. One is called, like, UAE Warriors Arabia, and the other one's called UAE Warriors Africa. Which card are you going to fight on?
I'm actually fighting on the 27th.
Okay. The Africa card.
On the Africa card.
Okay.
I'm not sure, like, if that means they're only taking normally, like, people from the African continent and having them, but I'm also fighting a girl. I think she's from somewhere in Arabia, so I was surprised that we were on the 27th rather than the 25th. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'll be fighting on the 27th.
Yeah, I don't really think it matters, like, what the card is called. It's just, you know, you get on a card, you know, get on
just
a card,
on
you're
an
fighting,
name.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, so what do you know? You know, who's your opponent? You know, can you give us any details about it? Because there's nothing out there online.
Yeah, so I'm fighting a girl called Mona Fatoui. I think I've said that right. That's how the commentators have said it. So normally she's actually been fighting at flyweight, but I don't think she cuts because she's always relatively quite small compared to her opponents that I noticed. But she is announced as a striker, and I think that's coming from the background of, like, just learning striking from MMA. She's scrappy. Like, she's a bit wild and uncontrolled. She throws some big punches, which is something that I've obviously been taking note of. I haven't really gotten to see much grappling from her. I did see in one of her fights she was trying to wrestle the other girl who was a kickboxing world champion. But even then, like, nothing much happened. She didn't really get many of the takedowns. So I'm prepared for, like, that she's going to be quite wild and aggressive. So that's what I've noticed about her.
Well, you know, in the past, you know, you faced a lot of technical strikers, right? So when you go up against someone that's wild and kind of, yeah, just wild, you know, is it more fun for you, or would you rather fight somebody that's more technical?
It's funny because when people are a little bit crazy and awkward, it can sometimes bring you down to that level, which is, you know, and I've discussed this with so many people that sometimes I have had a harder time sparring rookies rather than sparring, like, professional fighters and technical fighters, because they do unorthodox shit and it shouldn't land, but sometimes it does because you get really caught off guard and you don't expect it. But she's definitely not a rookie, and I think that it is going to be an entertaining fight, of course, but I do know that I'm not going to just bite down and try and stand in the pocket and fight like how maybe I would have normally back in the Muay Thai days. I've definitely been working on moving around a lot more, my distance and range. So I think that I can totally use it to my advantage, her being wild and uncontrolled, especially because I'm going to be taller and longer. And I think I do have more weapons in the sense of kicks, elbows, knees, like all that sense coming from Muay Thai. But I think that it will make it very exciting. And I'm definitely going to go in there with my chin down.
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, in your last fight, you didn't really get to show too much of your striking, you know, against a striker. So this time around, maybe there's going to be or maybe the fight would just be a little bit longer. Right. So you could actually show more. And I'm pretty sure you wanted to in your last fight.
Yeah. So my last fight was really bittersweet. Because, I mean, I really wanted that win with the rear naked choke. And actually, the whole camp, that's exactly what I had envisioned. I just, I mean, who doesn't want to have a win in 45 seconds, you know, just get in and get out. But also, I do really want more cage time for experience, because I feel like that's also, like, the best way to learn and everything like that. And even when I got on to the phone with my father later on, he was like, oh, I'm so happy that you won. But I would have really loved to have seen a little bit of, like, what you've been doing since you've been over in Thailand. So I definitely don't think that this one's going to finish that fast. And I am looking forward to getting some real cage time and really showing off some of the stuff that I've been working on.
What were the nerves like, you know, in the first, let's say, 15, 20 seconds of that fight, your last fight?
Do you know what? I actually wasn't nervous. I actually, sitting in the back, I felt so calm and collected. It was a confidence I felt that I hadn't really brought in to a fight with me for a long time. And I recall, like, sitting at the back, and you can see, like, your opponent just sitting on the other side of the stage, And the fight before us was kind of like just a WrestleMania. It was just one guy getting slammed over and over. And I knew that in this fight, I was definitely the stronger grappler. And I could see kind of across at Apodet that she was watching the fight thinking, or I assumed that she was thinking like, shit, I really don't want that to happen to me. And that can be really unsettling when you watch the guy get smashed right before you. But I felt really cool and collected, and I felt really good getting in there. So even when we started out, there are mistakes that I had made that I can see, like, even in just that period of time, that I've definitely gone away and been like, okay, don't want to do that in the next go. But I really wasn't feeling nervous. I was feeling really confident and excited more than anything.
How does it feel to have something in your mind, something you're envisioning in the fight to happen and winning the fight a certain way, and it actually happens, you know? Because, you know, you told me in the interview ahead of that fight that this is what you want, and 9 times out of 10, you know, it doesn't happen that way, but you got it. And was it a surprise, like, right when you got the tap, like, right when you won?
Almost no, like, because I had it wasn't even just the fact that I was envisioning, I just had a gut feeling. I felt like I wasn't just creating it, but almost that it was already there, like that is what was going to happen. And I had worked over that back take and that choke so many times that when it happened, it was like, oh well, I was here a million times in my camp, and I actually wasn't surprised. I was surprised that it happened so quickly, and at first I was sort of overwhelmed, and then I was suddenly underwhelmed because everything had happened so fast. But I didn't, I wasn't surprised. And the only thing that was weird to me was it felt like reliving my debut, but from Casey's position. Even after the fight, when I went out and spoke to Apodet, and, you know, I told her, hey, this is exactly what happened to me. And I was a lot older, you know, she's only 18. I was 24 at the time. I said, I was a lot older than you, but I still had the time to go away and completely work on that. So, yeah, it was bizarre. It was like being in my debut again, but from the other perspective.
You touch upon that aspect of, you know, it was supposed to happen that way, and that's what you felt. Is there like a sense of freedom thinking that in your mind, you know, in the fight?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, like, I'm not going to say that life just hands you anything and you have to work for everything. But also, I had this feeling of, like, I've stayed so committed to this. And despite all the obstacles and, like, all the times I thought maybe I just wasn't going to get an opportunity, you know, now I'm being presented with one. And like I said, I wasn't going to take away anything from Apodet, but I just knew that that was mine. I just knew that I was sort of being given, like, a little bit of a break from life, where they're like, hey, okay, here's the perfect fight for you, where, you know, now we're about to start paving the way. But I've completely had to be working, like, this whole time. You know, it's not like I've just been sitting around at home doing nothing and then this has happened. There's been, you know, so much work and progress behind all of that. So I just had this feeling that I couldn't explain, where I knew I was going to win, and I knew I was going to choke her out. And whether it was the first round or the third round, I knew that was how the fight was going to happen.
And on the side of, like, let's say, obstacles or barriers coming up in your career, because they're going to come up, right? There's going to be setbacks. Will you be able to better handle that, do you think, because of that? Because of the attitude of, like, you know, certain things were just supposed to happen at that certain time.
Yeah, like, I think from this, I'm just learning now. And you know, even Richie said this when I was in South Africa, and George and Alex have said this the whole time I've been here, just to trust in the process, and just to work and trust that, like, you know, things are going to happen. And I'm realizing it's not really my business how it's going to happen. And life has a really mysterious way of presenting the opportunities to you and rewarding you for your work. But I just know I have to stay committed and work really hard and keep envisioning and having this visualization of how I want my future to be, and life will find a way to present it to me so long as I, you know, manifest it, I guess.
You know, that fight was in January, right in the middle of January. So you've had pretty much, what, 2 months or so of training to prepare for this fight. How long have you known about this upcoming fight in UAE?
So about, I want to say it was like 2 weeks after, because I had a week, sort of a week off. I didn't do nothing, but I just did some light running at home, you know, enjoyed not being in camp. And then George said, "Hey, I might have a fight for you in March or in February." He thought it might actually be, and he said it would be in Africa. And at that time, I thought, "Oh, that how cool would that be if I had to go and fight in South Africa?" Because that's kind of where it started for me, you know. And I have a whole group of friends and stuff that I would love to see. And so he had told me, but we weren't sure. And then another week or so went by, and I remember I'm standing there in training, and I look at George and I said, "Hey, so what about that fight?" And he looked at me and he goes, "Oh yeah, you're fighting. You got the fight." I thought, "Oh, okay, you know, thanks for letting me know." And I think that was about 5 weeks ago where I was like, "Okay, I'm in camp." And I mean, I had just fought anyway, so it's not like I went away and I've had all this time off and suddenly I've lost fitness or any of that. So it's kind of like just getting straight back into it. And because in Muay Thai, I fought very frequently, back to back all the time, it wasn't an uncomfortable thing of, "Oh, now I've got to get straight back into fight camp." I mean, I'm actually used to fighting very close to previous fights. So yeah, it actually feels a little bit normal for me to just jump straight back into a camp.
Yeah, it's momentum, right? And I also saw that you had a couple different bodies throughout that couple weeks. You know, Wynn was there, and she got a win like a couple weeks after you
Rear
did.
naked choke as
Yeah,
well.
same thing. You know, she just a different avenue of the rear naked choke, right? Just how she got there. And then there was another training partner you had. Could you talk about training with them and getting Wynn for ready for her fight, and just, you know, overall?
So Wynn came, she was only here like training with us for about a week before the fight. So it was obviously going light and easy. She was actually preparing to stand because the girl she was fighting is a was supposed to be a wrestler. So the way that happened was sort of like, "Oh, well, we weren't didn't expect that." And then Jacinta Austin came, which was so great for me because we're both Muay Thai striker girls who have both come into MMA. And actually, Jacinta and I had been offered to fight her in 2018 for a Muay Thai fight, but the rule set because of where she lived was it had to be padded. And because I had already had about 12, 13 professional Muay Thai fights at the time, I think even 15, I said to Angie, I said, "It doesn't make sense for me to go back and have an amateur fight." So I actually turned it down and I ended up fighting on Warriors Way in Melbourne. So it was so great when Jacinta came out because I knew it would be, I knew it was going to be like competitive in that sense, but I don't even know how to explain it. It wasn't competitive at all, like maliciously, but we were definitely always pushing each other to our limits and exposing strengths and weaknesses. I wish that she could have stayed. She's fighting this coming weekend on Eternal. Yeah, so she came in preparation for her fight as well. We both fight in the same weight class, so it was really nice to have a female body my size. Lona's been away since her fight. So it was really, really great, and I loved training with Jacinta. I was really, really sad when she left, actually. We became good friends over those couple of weeks, and I hope that she will come back soon. And it was nice because I had a little bit of variety for the period of time that they were there. I mean, we had another girl, I think it was Veronica. She was here also. So I had about four girls to train with at the time, which was great because my last fight camp, I literally had Top Noi and George as my sparring partners. And George is 80 something odd kilos, and Top Noi is just Top Noi. I like, there's never going to be a day in my life that I'm going to beat him, no matter how much I think I can. And so it was great to have them, but you know, they've been gone now, so it's back to sparring mostly with Top Noi and George. And for wrestling, I have a few other bodies. I have Shay, and there's another couple of guys, which is fine. Like, I think as a female, you got to be used to at times having camps with just guys because there is a lack of female bodies. And you know, before we all moved to Bangtan, I did have about five or six other girls to train with. So it was really, I think that was really great at the time, but also I've over time just really started to love training with Top Noi, and he pushes me to every limit that I have. And he's also so patient. He's really patient, because sometimes I might get a little bit frustrated and maybe I start to throw punches a little bit harder, but he knows how to just, he just knows how to talk to me and you know, pull me back in line when I need it. So I'm really grateful to have Top Noi. He's fantastic.
And that's a good sign that you've had, you know, people outside of Thailand coming in to train, which means the world is opening up, and you never know who's going to step into the gym in the next couple of months or weeks, even after your fight at UAE Warriors to train with. It's great to see. The gym is very close to being completely built, I see. And I heard that they're going to open it up probably in April fully.
April 1st, I think they're aiming for.
Right after your fight.
Yeah, right after I fight. And I think it's really cool because we aren't open yet, technically, but we've had so many people come through already. And we have already, you know, there's like 10, 11 people on the mat, you know, in the MMA sessions. I'm sometimes a little bit less, but the jiu-jitsu is always really busy. You know, the wrestling class has a lot of bodies. So, I mean, I just can't wait until it's really officially running. And we have a Muay Thai section, and the strength and conditioning section's just been... I think it's just been finished. I can't wait to use it. I think everything's just, I feel like I don't know everything because, you know, I'm not behind the scenes doing all the shit that Alex and George has to do, but I feel like everything's just going perfect at the moment, and I'm so excited.
Yeah, it's great. And, you know, like we said in the last interview, that you've been there when it was just nothing. It was just a mat area and dust flying everywhere and nails.
It feels so long ago.
It's like a shopping center now for fighting. It's turning into that, right?
It looks beautiful. Just even like the color scheme, it's epic. It's better than I could have ever imagined. And it's really cool seeing it now, because I remember when we hadn't even put the mats down in there, as in like the puzzle mats. Alex did this little tour with us and he explained everything, and now when I look at it, I remember Alex said this is how it was going to be, and he had this vision from the beginning. And Alex is a little bit of a perfectionist, which has been so beneficial, because, you know, he knows exactly how he wants everything to be. I mean, it just it's definitely going to be the best gym in Thailand, without Southeast Asia, without a doubt in my mind. I just and because, you know, the thing about George and Alex and Frank and Woody and stuff, it's like they have a passion for this, and they have the name. And, you know, George built the MMA in Tiger, you know, to be what it was, and so he's not starting with nothing. You know, they already have the name. I can't see this not being perfect.
With yourself, you know, you're fighting on the 27th. What are you envisioning this time around?
I don't want to like jinx myself, but I think I might get the knockout for this one. Like I, you know, all my TKOs and stuff have come from like body shots, and I know I've got a killer left kick. I really think that I might take her out with a left head kick in this fight. That's the vision. And I'm feeling as strongly about it as I felt for my previous fight. And that could be because now I am riding a wave of confidence at the moment. You know, George says like, oh, you move differently in the gym. You can tell that you're feeling yourself a little bit. So it could be from that, but I really feel like that's what's going to, I feel like that's how it's going to play out. I don't know what round. I'm thinking maybe mid second round, but that's how I think it's going to go down.
All right. Well, it's good that you're able to travel, and there's still shows in Thailand. So even if you wanted to fight maybe a month from now or 2 months from now, there's shows going on, right? I'm pretty sure. Have you been reached out to by other promotions?
I was literally reached out to yesterday by a promotion in Hua Hin who wanted me to fight on April the 4th. It's just it's not even about having a fight a few days out, but it's, you know, obviously the weight's at 52. To fight and then get back straight down to that weight is just going to be very exhausting on my body. But I did tell them that after this fight, when I'm back, like I would love to, I mean, I'm happy to be as active as possible. And I have it literally written in my goals book that I would fight 2 to 4 times this year. by the time 2023 happened. I didn't think I would get a fight so quickly after my last one. But if I come out uninjured and ready for the next one, I mean, I would be happy to go in another couple of months. I just want to stay as active as I can and ride the momentum and get the experience in that I've missed out on for the past 2.5 years.
Well, that's good. That's good signs. You know, you just got to take care of business on March 27th at UAE Warriors. And I guess we'll be seeing you again soon.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't think we were going to get to have a chat this soon. But hopefully you just keep going riding out like this. And then, I mean, I feel like if I keep moving at this pace, that big things could happen by the end of next year for me, which would just be great, because I've been staying committed, and it's been difficult at times, but I'm starting to, you know, I feel like I'm starting to be rewarded for everything I've been doing.